continue this lecture.
Thank you. Let me just briefly recall the notation so I have it in the blackboard to refer to it. The setup that we discussed yesterday was the following, that X was a projective variety. Just to have then K was a family, actually a dominating family of rational curves of minimal degrees. And then X in X, a general point. Well, and then there's Kx. That's the subfamily of all rational curves of minimal degree that actually contain X. So this is L in K, which contain X. And we have seen that this is actually proper. And basically, the main statement of yesterday was that in the setup where I have the manifold X here, then there's a point. Then I look at those lines that contain the point X, then they can't be all too singular. Finitely, many of them can have singularities at X, but really these singularities can only be immersed. They never look like cusps. And let me draw a corollary from this. So corollary to yesterday's result. That is, if I try to define the following map, it goes from the space of minimal degree rational curves and ends up in the space of tangent directions at the point X, and it's defined by mapping a curve to its tangent direction, like this. So basically, this curve here, this will be then mapped to its tangent direction here, like this. And the corollary is that because the singularities, I mean, this map is obviously not defined where curves are singular. So if a curve is like has a cuspidal singularity at X, then I wouldn't know what tangent direction to associate with it. And if it has a nodal singularity, then I would have two choices. But since this here really doesn't happen, it's rather easy to check the following, namely the rational map this is, if I don't take it from the space of rational curves through X, but rather I start from the normalization. This is a finite morphism. So basically, what I'm saying is that if I forget about the normalization for a second, then this map will have indeterminacies where we have nodal singularities. But what I'm claiming, and it's not really difficult, but I don't want to spend any time on this here, is that normalization takes care of these ambiguities here. And the reason why I'm mentioning this corollary is the following. I'd like to look at the image. So the image of this tangent direction morphism inside of P of Tx at x. This is called the variety of minimal rational tangents. It's the variety of minimal rational tangents. Or sometimes the variety of minimal rational tangents you call the union of all these images as X moves on the on the space capital X. And it's not actually a statement what I write here. It's more, what do you call this, fact? I don't know, idea maybe. that the image, so the variety of minimal rational tangent, that is of course an invariant of our setup here. So in particular, all its numerical invariants as a subvariety of this projective space, these are invariants of the setup. And this is an incredibly strong invariant. That's what I want to say. It is a very strong invariant. And to underline this, I just mention a result of Wang and Mok. Basically, they're saying if X, Y are Fano manifold, second Betti number, equals 1. Is it difficult to read something? Okay. Second Betti number is 1. And assume there we fix families of rational curves of minimal degrees. So fix families, say, K and K prime on X and Y, respectively. Now, so here is the manifold X. Here is a manifold Y. And what I want to say, if I pick a general point here and a general point here, and then I take a small analytic open neighborhood like a polycylinder of these two, and say I have a morphism between these two polycylinders, then the statement is, if this morphism between the small polycylinders, if that respects the variety of minimal rational tangents, then it extends to a global isomorphism. So that basically tells us this is really a very, very strong invariant indeed. It contains all the information about X, even locally. responsibility, respectively, oh my God, respectively, X, Y, these should be general points with open neighborhoods, or I should say analytic open neighborhoods U and V, and if there's an isomorphism of U and V that respects the variety of minimal rational tangents plus some technical condition that I don't even mention. So, and if there exists an isomorphism phi from U to V that respects the variety of minimal rational tangents, and if some technical conditions holds, then phi extends to an isomorphism from X to Y. So this is a strong invariant. And just to give you an idea what you can do with it, actually there exists a large body of pardon?
Same dimension.
Yeah, that's because locally, analytically, they are isomorphic.
I know that it's rational, minimal rational tangent goes to minimal rational tangent.
And the same for the inverse.
Same for the inverse.
Oh. Right. Right. So we have a large number of results. Where the variety of minimal rational tangents was studied, they're mostly due to Professor Wang and Mok. So one thing you can immediately read off the variety of minimal rational tangents, you can immediately tell, if you know its projective geometry, if the tangent bundle of the manifold X is stable or not. So that was, for instance, used to prove the stability of the tangent bundle for these moduli spaces of vector bundles. So, stability of the tangent bundle. That's used, was used for proving the deformation rigidity for a large number of homogeneous spaces. For homogeneous spaces. And for instance, to prove the Lazarsfeld conjecture on the existence or non-existence of isomorphisms morphism starting from rational homogeneous varieties. So non-existence morphisms from rational homogeneous varieties. So obviously I can't explain all these results, so I restrict to one case, and I will do that tomorrow, and that will be the uniqueness of context structures. That also has to do with the variety of minimal rational tangents. So basically, for today, this is what I wanted to say about it. And then I would like to set off in a different direction and discuss a question that I mentioned yesterday already. So yesterday, basically, the problem that we gave a partial answer to was we have a manifold that's covered by a minimal degree rational curve. We fix two points, and we ask how many curves are there connecting these two points. So we know, in general, it's finitely many, and we gave criteria that guarantee that it's really unique. And the other question was, what if we have a space that contains really the maximum number of minimal degree rational curves, meaning that given any two points, I can always connect these with a minimal degree curve. And the conjecture was that this is really, that this characterizes the projective space. And that's what I would like to prove today. So this is, I believe, I lost track of the numbering. Chapter 4, characterizations of projective spaces. So before I explain the result and give an idea of its proof, let me make a little detour and discuss the variety of minimal rational tangents once more. So the detour is more on the space of rational curves on X. So I remarked to the experts that one can easily construct the space of rational curves by looking at the appropriate sub-variety, quasi-projective sub-variety of the Chow variety. Today I would like to give another construction of the space of rational curves, or maybe just name it, namely the idea how one could equivalently construct that space of construction is we don't want to discuss the Chow variety because we have no idea of its infinitesimal structure. Rather, we would like to look at the space of homomorphisms from P1 into our manifold X. And really, we don't want to have any homomorphisms. We want to have generically injective homomorphisms. So that BIR for birationally, that means generically injective subvariety of the HOM, or subscheme of the HOM scheme, of course. And well, if F and G in this HOM scheme are two generically injective morphisms that have the same image, then probably you believe me if I say that these morphisms, they're basically the same. They may differ by an automorphism from pre-1. So then F, G differ by an automorphism of the projective space, which is the source of the maps, which of course would be completely wrong if the morphism weren't generically injective. So that makes it plausible that one can construct an isomorphism which starts at the set or the HOM scheme P1, X, and identifies that with the rational curves on X, only that I have to mod out here the automorphism group of P1, basically. The problem is that this quotient here, maybe, at least to me, is not so clear if it exists, because there is no reason for this scheme to be normal or reduced or anything, and then I'm terribly scared about taking the quotient. Maybe it does exist, I don't know really. So what I would rather do is I go to the normalizations. Then there's geometric invariant theory, and it's almost elementary to see that this quotient here really exists, and this gives an isomorphism between the normalization of the space of rational curves and the quotient starting from the normalized HOM scheme. So this N is again normalization. And then modding out automorphisms that come from the source. So why would anybody want to do this? A priori, perhaps it doesn't make the matter much easier. But what we have effectively won in representing the space of rational curves in that way is we have a very good understanding of the tangent space of the HOM scheme. So here is a fact that if F is a morphism, HOM P1X, then the tangent space of the HOM scheme P1X at the point F, this is really nothing but sections on P1 that are in the pullback of the tangent bundle. Of course, if X is a manifold. Otherwise, the tangent bundle is not so easy. Something similar can still be said, but it becomes more difficult. So if X is smooth, I have to have that assumption. Right. And it's also known that the dimension of the HOM scheme at the point F, this is bigger or equals to H naught of the tangent space minus H1 of the pullback of the tangent space. And since P1 is a curve, that difference here can be expressed by using the Riemann-Roch theorem. And the result, if you apply Riemann-Roch, and if I don't have the numbers wrong, is, so this is equal Riemann Roch. That should be the degree of the pullback of minus kx plus the dimension of x. So basically, as a result, we can, well, we have an estimate on the dimension of the space of rational curves. So, conclusion. If L is a minimal degree rational curve on X, then we know that the dimension of the space is bigger or equals to, well, we need to normalize L, we need to pull back the anticanonical bundle to L and look at its degree. That is commonly denoted by the intersection number, plus the dimension of X minus the dimension of PSL2, which we have modded out. So minus, that should be 3, I hope. And, well, we have a similar construction. For the space of curves that contain X, space of curves that contain point little x, and the result is, again, we represent it as a quotient. Then here there's the Homme scheme, but we impose the additional property that the point 0 at p1 is mapped to the point little x in x. We have to mod out not PSL2, but really the automorphism group that fixes the point 0 here, and you get a similar identification. So the result is here that dim kx is bigger or equals to minus kx times L, now minus 2, 2 being the dimension of the automorphism group that fixes one point. So, and we can immediately check if these numbers are right, because I draw another conclusion now, which I know what should be the proper result. Namely, recall Morris bend and break. Basically, Morris bend and break says that if I have the manifold, I have a point here, I have all these curves through the point, then I take a point in here, and there are really only finitely many curves containing little x and the other point y here. So that can be formulated equivalently in saying that the dimension of the space of curves through X is always less or equals than the dimension of X minus 1. Namely, if that were bigger, then I would have a family of curves here that has very high dimension. However, it covers only a space that has a relatively small dimension, and therefore there must be lots of curves that contain two given points. And as a result, or, well, immediate conclusion, we get an estimate for the intersection numbers that minimal degree rational curves have with the anti-canonical bundle. And I can compare this result with that here. So conclusion is that if you put the numbers in, then we obtain that the anti-canonical bundle times L should be less or equal to the dimension of X plus 1. Right. And if you look again at this these two inequalities, then the problem that we started with, namely, for any two points, are they connected by a minimal degree rational curves? This is reformulated equivalently in characterize all varieties for which equality holds here. Right. So before I write that down on the blackboard, I state another fact. Namely, we know the tangent space of the Hom variety. We also have some understanding how that tangent space relates to the universal morphism that starts from the Hom scheme. And let me just state as a fact that a further analysis of this first order data gives the following fact, namely that remind that x is a general point, so if I have a curve L that's contained, that's passing through that general point, and f from P1 to L, the normalization, then we have that the pullback of the tangent bundle is actually an F. And second, what you get from a further analysis, that if L is a curve that passes through a general point, and if it's a general curve of those, so if L is a general member, is general in Kx, then it's not just that we know that the pullback of the tangent bundle is nef, we really know what its splitting type is. Then the pullback of Tx splits as follows. It's O of 2 plus a number of copies of O of 1 plus a number of copies of O. So say we have A factors O of 1, and say we have B factors, which are actually O. These curves are called, in the language of people working in the field, they are called standard rational curves, because their splitting type is, what's the splitting type for most curves?
Does Bandas refer to the subseries of the 1 or 2 piece, or does it refer to...
Yes. Oh, you, for instance, you get an O of 3. And you get one of the O of 1s less. Because the degree still has to. You can also have several O of 2s, yes. Definitely.
Could you have no O of 2?
No, you can have one O of 3 and no O of 2, yeah. For instance, if you have a cuspidal curve. No, because at least the tangent bundle of P1 has to map into the pullback of the tangent bundle of Tx, right? So let me just say reformulation of the problem. So it's the following theorem, which goes back to Cho, Miyaoka, Shepherd Baron, and the proof I'm going to present involves some simplifications from my side. Is the following. So if any two points on X can be joined by a curve L in our family K, or an equivalent reformulation is now or if equivalently using these estimates here and using a little more of deformation theory, if the intersection number minus kx times L equals the dimension of x plus 1, which is what we expect for the projective space, right? Then x is really the projective space. Then x is the projective space. So let me, where's my notes? Let me, before the break, just write, at least set up the notation for the proof. So here is the rest of this lecture is the idea of proof for that. So we consider the normalization, because it makes matters much easier. Say H is the normalization of kx, and the normalization H of kx and the universal family U over H. So I'm writing too many words. I just want to write down a diagram. So here is the universal family U. Here is H. And because this is the normalizations, we know that the universal family becomes a P1 bundle. Then we have the morphism into X. And what I would like to do is I would like to compare U with the blow up of X at the point little x. Blow up of X at little x. So there's a rational map up here. And the aim of all this is I'd like to show that this rational map here is really an isomorphism. So aim show that iota hat is really isomorphic. So, and what can we use? Let's look at the magazines to see what weapons we find. Tools that we have available is, first, we know that Morris band and break holes, which is to say that this morphism iota, what does it look like? Here's the universal family, U, H, and these are really all curves that pass through little x. And what Morris band and break says, that if I take a point here, then there is at most finitely many curves containing that point little y also, which means that the morphism iota here, this is finite, away from the preimage of x. So know that iota is finite away from the preimage of x. Second tool I like to use is we know, so maybe I should mention, this is just the band and break statement. Then second tool, that's what we did last time. We know curves L in H, they have only immersed singularities at X. Then we know that, well, they may have immersed singularities, but really only finitely many of those. So only finitely many curves many L in H are singular. At X, and then the last tool is the knowledge of the normal bundle. So this is for if L in H is a general curve, then we know that L is smooth. And the normal bundle of L in X is O of 1 plus the dimension of X. Yeah, it's a couple of copies of O of 1, and it's the dimension of X minus 1 many. Right. This follows from because L is a normal curve. L is a normal curve. Okay, and then maybe after the break, I'm trying to put these pieces of the puzzle together. Thanks. So that'll be till 3 minutes past then, I believe. I forgot where I was, but here it's written. So, well. So that diagram, unfortunately, is in the way. I haven't started yet. So let me draw it again a little smaller at this side. We have X, we have the blow up, and we want to compare that to the universal family. And right, so this is Yota, this is Yota hat, and of course Yota hat may not be well defined. Actually, it is not well defined. If it's always well defined away from the pre-image of the point that we blow up, of course. And so let me recall what is the pre-image. So we have, well, there's the point X. Here's a curve. So if this is the associated curve in the universal family, it'll be a point. So most curves are smooth. So what I really get is a section, but then I may have finitely many curves that have nodal singularities, and then the pre-image is 2 points. So what I want to say is the pre-image of X is a section called sigma infinity. Section over H plus finitely many points. Say, I don't know what they are called, say YI, for instance. And we have some more. It's not only that we know that sigma is a section set theoretically. It's also, oh no, I just erased this. These curves, they have immersed singularities. So it's also a section scheme theoretically. I want to say this is reduced. Because, well, the differential doesn't vanish. And right, as a result, because this is reduced, the universal property of the blowing up construction tells us that the morphism iota hat is well defined along this section. That's the universal property of blow up just. So result, or maybe conclusion, is iota hat is well defined in a neighborhood of sigma infinity. And if it has any singularities, then they must be at those points yi. Not at the yi. And the proposition that I'd like to prove now is twofold. First, I would like to say, so maybe, no, I'm not drawing this. Say, let E in X hat, be the exceptional divisor. And what I would like to prove is that this exceptional divisor is exactly sigma infinity. So statement iota hat restricted to sigma infinity goes from sigma infinity to the exceptional divisor, which I recall from the blowing up construction is nothing but the projectivized tangent space. This is isomorphic. And second thing I would like to prove is that not only this morphism is isomorphic, but really the induced morphism on the normal bundle is also isomorphic. So this is T iota hat induces a morphism from the normal bundle of sigma infinity in U to the normal bundle of E in X hat. And if you are a little scared about the notion of normal bundle on a normal P1 bundle over a normal base, then, well, you know, there's this section sigma infinity here. And if that's P, if this is E, which is a projective space, then H will also be a projective space. So everything is smooth here. We are just discussing manifolds. And therefore, the notion of a normal bundle is not scary. So let's see how we do that. Oh, it seems that I have now so many things I don't want to erase on the blackboard that I can only use this. Because there's the proposition and here's the theorem.
Well, maybe.
The theorem has to go. And next time I produce handouts. Right. So, proof of proposition. Yep. Oh, sorry, this is also isomorphic. It's an isomorphism of vector bundles. Thank you. And, well, okay, we want to show that this is an isomorphism of vector bundles. Actually, they are just line bundles. So what we would have to show is that this morphism between line bundles doesn't have any zeros. So assuming one is true, so the spaces are the same. But what does it mean that it doesn't have any zeros? That means exactly that the differential doesn't vanish. And this comes for free because we have only immersed singularities. So let me write that down. Assuming one holds, two is immediate from the fact that iota hat, or the differential, the tangent morphism of iota hat, so the derivative has rank 2, has maximal rank actually, not 2, maximal rank along sigma infinity. And this is because the curves are immersed. So basically, the picture looks like that. There's the universal family U here. There are some funny points that I can't control, and I go up with the morphism to something that looks pretty much the same. There's the exceptional divisor E here. Then there are the strict transforms of the minimal degree rational curves. And, well, I mean, these curves here, they map isomorphically on these curves here. So the associated map between normal directions is never zero. That's all there is. So really, we only have to prove one. So only need to prove one. So we want to show that sigma infinity and the exceptional divisor E, that they are isomorphic. And they are, of course, both normal spaces, because one is a section over a space that we started to define as the normalization of something. And E is, of course, a projective space. So, and to show that that a morphism between normal spaces is isomorphic, it suffices to show that it's finite. So not finite, suffices to show. We know already that it's finite, because this is, I should write that down. This is exactly the tangent map Tx that we have. So we note that iota hat from sigma infinity is exactly the tangent map tau x that I discussed in the first lecture. Namely, it takes a point on the normalized space of all curves here and associates to it its tangent direction. Now it starts from sigma infinity, but sigma infinity and h, they are isomorphic. And associates to a point here the tangent direction of the associated rational curve. So this is hence finite. Right, and what I wanted to say is that by Zariski's main theorem, to show that a finite map between normal spaces and isomorphic is isomorphic, it suffices to show that it's birational. Okay, we are in characteristic zero, so we only need to show that iota hat restricted to sigma infinity is generically finite. Right, that's what I wanted to say. By Zariski's main theorem. Generically injective, yes. Thank you. So, and I'd like to argue by contradiction. So assume not. then let me draw a picture of what's going on again. So there is the exceptional divisor E here. Then there are some curves that are a little difficult to draw in a way so that it doesn't look exactly like the proposition that we want to show actually holds already. So then there's U here, H here. And now let me mark in yellow a general curve that, or the strict transform of a general curve L. Strict transform of a general curve L in H. So what does its preimage look like? So there's this point here. And assuming the morphism is not generically injective, its preimage will contain two points like this. And well, that's a curve that comes from our family. So its preimage will definitely contain a fiber. But then the preimage, I want to say that, you know, the preimage of this little analytic open neighborhood is these two little analytic open neighborhoods. So, and the yellow curve has also a preimage in the other neighborhood, but it can't be a fiber because there is a one-to-one correspondence between fibers of H and rational curves on the other side. So it is like a section or a multi-section. So let me summarize that. Assume not. Then if L in H is a general curve, then iota to the minus 1 of L contains a curve B. B, which lives in the universal family, such that the following holds. A, B is not a fiber. Second, B is not contained in sigma infinity. But third, B does intersect sigma infinity. And I claim that's a contradiction. And to see that this is a contradiction is again done by passing to a uniruled or to a ruled surface here and doing intersection numbers. And this time I figure that once in the series of lectures I should show the computation of intersection numbers. So let me do it once here, because I always said that, you know. So I need to make this a ruled surface to start with. So here is the component B. And of course, I'd like to go to the image of B. So I do a base change. Now perform a base change. So replacing H by the normalization of the image of pi of B. So what do we get? we obtain a diagram as follows. There's the universal family here that lives over H. So we go to the normalization of the image of B, which is now a smooth curve. Then we have something like UB, and there's the morphism here. And so basically, if I were to draw UB, somehow it's a ruled surface over B prime. There's the section here. And then I have at least the pre-image of B. And after another base change, we can assume, I mean, I always draw this as if that was a section. It could actually be a multi-section. We have no control on that. But I make a base change, then I will find a section. So this morphism here is beta, say. Assume beta to the minus 1 of B contains a section sigma, a section sigma. OK, now I want to calculate intersection numbers on the surface. So here is sigma. Here is the section which comes from the pre-image of X. So let me again call that sigma infinity, although it lives in a different space, but it's still the pre-image of X. And well, in order to compute intersection numbers, we fix an ample line bundle on X, then pull it back to UB. So let H, we had already. So H in pick UB be the pullback of an ample bundle on X. And what do we have? We have sigma infinity intersects the bundle H with multiplicity 0. Then we have sigma infinity intersects a fiber with a certain multiplicity m, say. Now I just have to make sure that I use the numbers correctly. Say for simplicity 1. You don't like this? Okay. I use M. And then we have sigma infinity dot sigma. This is M times D, where D is the mapping degree of this morphism restricted to sigma. I explain it in a second. Uta B, where D is, say, where Uta B restricted to sigma is D to 1, like that. So why is that? Well, a fiber obviously goes to a minimal degree rational curve. Sigma, however, it also goes to a minimal degree rational curve. Actually, it was constructed like that. Like, I take this minimal degree rational curve, or rather, here it's strict transform, and then B was a component of its preimage. So this is because sigma also maps to a minimal degree rational curve. It maps via a D to 1 map. So its intersection number should be D times that intersection number, because fibers are mapped isomorphically onto their images. So So because iota B restricted to fiber maps a fiber 1:1 to a minimal degree rational curve, and iota B restricted to sigma maps sigma D:1 to a minimal degree rational curve. So the intersection numbers differ by a factor of D. And conclusion is that the conclusion is that, you know, the Picard number of a ruled surface over a curve is actually 2. So I am able to express sigma in terms of sigma infinity on the fiber. And if you put these numbers together, then we obtain that sigma is numerically equivalent to sigma infinity plus D times the fiber. Is that correct? Yep. So, and what else do we have? We have that sigma infinity in this surface is contracted to a curve. Well, yep. Yeah? Infinity on this side? Right-hand side is more correct, you say? Right. Oh my God, I had a very good reason to never show you these computations there. Sigma infinity is contracted. So we know that sigma infinity square is less than 0. But we also have one more piece of information that we can use. We know what the normal bundle of the rational curve is that the fibers and that sigma map to. We know the normal bundle of these rational curves. These are just copies of O of 1 because we started with a general curve and they are standard. So we have the normal bundle of iota B of sigma is several copies of O of 1, and that tells us something about the normal bundle of sigma in the surface. Namely, the normal bundle of sigma in the surface has degree at most D. So, consequence, the normal bundle of sigma in UB has degree less or equals to D. Because I have a morphism from this surface into X, so there's a morphism from the normal bundle of sigma into the normal bundle of the curve that it maps to. And of course, I'm sweeping on under the rug that this morphism might actually be 0. It is not. Let me just say it like that. So we know that sigma square is less or equals to 0. Now, if you put these three pieces of information together, you obtain the following.
Excuse me.
Yep.
I don't understand why you don't, if your relation is correct, why you don't already have a contribution. If you intersect with sigma infinity.
If I intersect with.
Relation on the top.
Yep.
You're
right.
Side.
Yeah.
And then according to what you, the intersection numbers you calculated, you should get sigma infinity squared equals 0.
Sigma infinity squared equals 0.
Sigma infinity dot sigma is m times d.
once again.
So your calculator is there, right? Sigma infinity dot S is M.
Sigma infinity dot the fiber.
Yeah.
This is nonsense. What did I write here? This is sigma infinity dot a fiber is of course 1. Because 1 is a section and the other is a fiber.
I see.
Okay, this is my god. I want to have the intersection number of a fiber with H, and this is then M. Thank you. Right, and then if sigma maps d to 1 onto the minimal rational curve, then it should be d times that. M is at least 1, yeah. Because H is the pullback of an ample bundle, so it intersects. Yeah, but that fiber doesn't map to 0. It doesn't map to a point. It maps to a minimal degree rational curve.
Oh, right. Is that not the thing which is
contracted? The thing that's contracted is sigma infinity, and here the intersection number is 0. So, right, putting. These together. Yields that the intersection number of sigma with sigma infinity is actually 0. That's the only way that these two inequalities can be satisfied. And I guess I play it safe and I don't show you the computation right now, because otherwise it'll be a mess again. But it's really very easy. You just get the inequality signs right and put them together. So, right, but that's. That's a contradiction, because we started with constructing this sigma in a way that it intersects sigma infinity in a finite number of points. That was property 2 or 3 from the properties that B satisfied. Because sigma and sigma infinity do intersect. Okay, that's not possible. So the proposition is shown. And now to conclude, the characterization of the projective space is really not that difficult anymore if we are willing to invest some nuclear weapon to kill a sparrow. Now, a situation is like this. So here's the P1 bundle over a base H, which we have identified as the projective space. Then here is X. So this is a P1 bundle with a section sigma infinity isomorphic to Pn minus 1. Whose normal bundle is O of minus 1 and can be contracted to a point by this map. So what should that be? So the answer is, if we have a P1 bundle with a section that's isomorphic to Pn minus 1 and normal bundle O of minus 1, and we blow that down, we obtain the projective space. So since normal bundle of sigma infinity, which is the same as Pn minus 1, is O Pn minus 1 minus 1, because that's what the normal bundle of E in the blow-up is. We have this morphism iota factors via the blowdown via blowdown blowdown of U to Pn. So this diagram really looks like U goes to Pn, goes to X, here is the morphism iota, and here is H. So there is only one P1 bundle with a section whose normal bundle is O of minus 1. That's Pn blown up in one point. OK, now we have a morphism from Pn into the manifold X, which is a priori finite. And now one could draw the nuclear weapons and say that's the result from Lazarsfeld's thesis. There is no morphism from Pn to any manifold, except that manifold is actually Pn itself. And that's an isom. Yeah. So No. And for Lazarsfeld result, you don't need it.
Yeah, but forget Lazarsfeld here. But how far did you go here without
Lazarsfeld? Oh, you get it with two more minutes of explanation. Because you have these minimal degree rational curves here. They intersect the canonical bundle with multiplicity n plus 1, n being the dimension of x. You have the lines here that intersect the canonical bundle of Pn with multiplicity n plus 1. Now you use the adjunction formula for a branched covering and compare the intersection numbers here and there. And that also tells you immediately that this map is birational indeed. OK, so here it's much easier than so application of either Lazarsfeld's thesis or adjunction formula. Whatever you like better yields X is really isomorphic to the projective space. Right. Yep. Oh, no, no, but we have shown in the proposition that the section.
I understand that, yeah. but so we get it in the framework of the
quantum. Right. Right.
Yeah. Section
under, exactly, yeah. So if we knew that from the beginning, then the proof would have been much easier.
And here we were discussing, so Lazarsfeld's theorem, is that relying on their connectivity theorem, or is that more elementary?
I guess it's more elementary by looking at the push forward of the structure sheaf and then discussing positivity and negativity of that. So maybe it's good time to stop here.
For cookies? Yeah.